Alafia. This is Nkechi Taifa, civil and human rights attorney, scholar, activist, freedom fighter, and bestseller author. Welcome to Human Rights and Justice, my new talk show featuring kick-ass commentary and stimulating guests. We discuss domestic and global themes, highlighting political, economic, and social rights. Get up and stand up with me, Nkechi Taifa, for human rights and justice.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
By any means necessary, get up and stand up. Human rights and justice with Nkechi Taifa. Welcome. Welcome to episode 2 of Human Rights and Justice. Ooh, I'm so thrilled. And I am just so very thrilled with the feature that we're going to share this day on this second episode in just a few after our preliminaries. My feature is going to be called Mourn or Scorn. Mourn or Scorn, the Black World and Queen Elizabeth's Death. We're going to have a riveting conversation with two experts who are going to illuminate us on this whole issue of, is the Black world mourning? Are we scorning? Should we be mourning or should we be scorning? But first, as we start off with each episode of Human Rights and Justice, I want to share just a little bit of Black facts from the week. And these Black facts first come from the Equal Justice Initiative calendar. And we're talking about the week starting September 11th. And on the 11th in 1895, South Carolina convenes the Constitutional Convention with the explicit purpose to disenfranchise African-Americans. September 12th, 1966, white mobs attack African-American students attempting to integrate schools in Grenada, Mississippi. September 13th, 1907, Michigan Annual Conference of the Methodist Episcopal Church votes against ordaining Black bishops. September 14th, 1874, white supremacist military attacks New Orleans and overthrows Louisiana's elected integrated state government in what becomes known as the Battle of Liberty Place. September 15th, 1963, white terrorists bombed 16th Street Baptist Church, a popular location for civil rights meetings in Birmingham, Alabama, murdering 4 young Black girls attending Sunday school. September 16th, 1928, Okeechobee hurricane kills 2,500 people in South Florida, mostly Black migrant farm workers. Over 600 Black victims are buried in segregated mass graves with no memorial. In September 17, 1630, Virginia Assembly sentences Hugh Davis, a white man, to be quote unquote soundly whipped before an assembly of Black people for, guess what, engaging in a relationship with a Black person. That was from Equal Justice Initiative. And now from our DC owned Black Seeds calendar, we who believe in freedom cannot arrest. September the 11th, former slaves repel slave kidnappers at Christiana, Pennsylvania in 1851. On September the 12th, Steve Biko, leader of the Black Consciousness Movement, murdered by South African government, 1977. September 13th, US troops murdered 32 prisoners at Attica prison. Prisoners were demonstrating for human rights, 1971. September 14th, Harlem Renaissance, Black cultural movement of authors and artists began in 1920. The 15th, again, 4 young Black girls murdered by Birmingham racists and bombing of Birmingham Church, 1963. And on September 16th, Claude Barnett, founder of Associated Negro Press, born in 1889. And because this is the week of the infamous assault against the human rights, basic human rights of prisoners at Attica prison, I'm going to do a brief reflection and then we're going to bring on our guest for our feature discussion today, Mourn or Scorn, the Black World and the Death of Queen Elizabeth. So I'm going to start off with this quote. We are men. We are not beasts, and we do not intend to be beaten and driven as such. The entire prison populace, that means each and every one of us here, have set forth to change forever the ruthless brutalization and disregard for the lives of the prisoners here and throughout the United States. What has happened here is but the sound before the fury of those who are oppressed. Those were the words read by Elliot L.D. Barkley on September 9, 1971, part of the preamble to the list of demands addressed to the people of the United States of America to seek to bring light to their treacherous experiences at New York's Attica State Prison. Elliot L.D. Barkley, his name is one that should be shouted out, honored and revered, like that of George Jackson, Jonathan Jackson, Fred Hampton. We're talking about a brave 21-year-old brother who was days away from his scheduled release date, who was the epitome of this statement, one is not free until all of us are free. A man who spoke truth to power. We need to remember his name, Elliot L.D. Barkley. And I want to take just a moment today at this time to acknowledge the memory of those who violently seized the moment and fought for their human rights against horrific odds, yet needlessly perished due to state retaliation on the day of September 13, 1971, 51 years ago. Do you know where you were on that day? I do. I was a 16-year-old glued to the 6 o'clock news of the black and white television screen in my family's living room, listening, watching in horror the images of powerless black men paraded naked through a prison yard after Attica, the prison in upstate New York, is needlessly stormed. I remember vividly how hard it was to hear the TV as torrential rains were beating against the front window of my family's home, rains that had pummeled the East Coast that week of September 9th through 13th, 1971. That is my memory. Think back to your own. Just as many of us know what we were doing the day Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated, or 9-1-1, if you were born of age during those times, where were you? And what were you doing when Attica exploded? 43 prisoners and hostages lay dead after the 4-day rebellion. Many more were wounded. Why? Prior to the assault, they had presented a manifesto of 27 demands to the Commissioner of Corrections, Russell Oswald, and Governor Nelson Rockefeller, summarized as following. We demand the constitutional rights of legal representation in parole board hearings. We demand a change in medical staff. There are numerous mistakes made, quote unquote mistakes, and improper and erroneous medication given by untrained personnel. We demand adequate visiting conditions. We demand an end to the segregation of prisoners due to their political beliefs. We demand an end to the punishment of prisoners who practice the constitutional right of peaceful dissent. We demand the right to subscribe to political papers and books. We demand that better food be served, that inmates wishing a pork-free diet should have one. And it went on, 27 detailed demands, nothing radical, brothers and sisters, just basic human rights. And after the takeover of the prison, after the murder of George Jackson, their initial demands, we want complete amnesty, meaning freedom from any and all physical, mental, and legal reprisals. We want speedy and safe transportation out of confinement to a non-imperialistic country. And we urgently demand immediate negotiations with listed observers who would guarantee safe passage of all people to and from the institution. We want them here to witness this degradation so that they can better know how to bring this degradation to an end. Listen up, my brothers and sisters. These were not mad, crazed prisoners, though they had every right to be. The prisoners were spot on organized. They methodically constructed what I would call departments with essential services such as medical, food preparation service, communication, security. We're talking about the necessity to feed and shelter and ensure the basic necessities of over 1,000 prisoners. The guards had been taken hostage, received food first, and there were prisoners assigned to watch over the guards and make sure those prisoners seeking revenge and retaliation for years of abuse against them did not cause them harm. But on September 13, 1971, hundreds of prisoners were shot, along with nine of the hostages. They all were shot by the stormtroopers. The prisoners had no guns, and many of the alleged leaders were selectively marked for assassination. One prisoner later said, "It was like slaughter, man. The people were defenseless. They had sticks and homemade weapons to defend themselves, but this doesn't compare, man, with magnums and carbines." Egregiously, the corrections department said that the hostages' throats were slashed by the prisoners. Blatant lies. The coroner's report later showed that no hostages died of slashed throats. All died of police gunshot wounds. Despite the humaneness and despite the restraint shown by the Attica brothers, after the prison was retaken, the men were subjected to extreme cases of brutality and torture, made to strip and crawl on the ground through the muddy yard, forced to run naked between a gauntlet of enraged white officers who tortured and beat them mercilessly with sticks and clubs. Elliot L.D. Barkley was among those murdered, marked for assassination, and shot in the back after the surrender. In conclusion, despite it all, as the result of the heroic stance and sacrifice of the Attica brothers during the uprising for human rights, changes were made throughout the New York State prison system, as well as in prisons across the country. New York State in particular, for the first time, began a grievance procedure, which was instituted. It was the dawning of a new day and mass attention to prison issues. And after decades in the courts, the state of New York finally agreed to pay $12 million to families of the Attica brothers to settle the case. And finally, we are in the streets today shouting, "Black Lives Matter. Get your knee off my neck. What do we want? Freedom. When do we want it? Now." We must never forget the heroism and the sacrifice of those from George Jackson to Elliot L.D. Barkley, and the roll call of names of human beings on this lost their lives this day, yesterday, September 13, 1971, 51 years ago. So thank you for allowing me to give that historic remembrance of Attica. May the memory of Attica never be forgotten. Woo! So now I got my brothers here on the screen. Oh my goodness. We're going to talk about what's been in the news nonstop. I mean, you know, I'm not really one on social media, but I happened to go on Black Twitter and just totally just blew my mind in terms of the passion that was coming out, that was emanating across the Black world with respect to the death of Queen Elizabeth. I have two great colleagues, two brothers in the struggle, two activists, you know, who are going to shed light on some of this from their own personal perspectives. We have Obi Egbuna Jr. We're talking about someone who is an African history teacher, a journalist, a children's playwright. We're talking about someone whose father, whose daddy, and he can tell us more about that, also was actually the founder of the Black Power movement in London, England. He himself is London, England born, native Washingtonian, journalist, correspondent, represented Pan-African Youth Student Movement to the National Youth Organizing Committee of the First Million Man March. I mean, his resume is very, very long, dealing specifically with activism and advocacy in support of Pan-Africanism all over and all across the world, you know, Zimbabwe, you know, Cuba, Venezuela. I mean, you mentioned it. And now I understand that he is in the process of republishing a book about the Black Power movement in Britain entitled Destroy This Temple, written by his daddy. So hopefully he'll share a little bit of that with us. And we also have with us Dr. Kelechi Egwim, a native Nigerian, a current Washingtonian DMV, longtime community activist, and a commentator on social justice issues, a lifetime member of the African Freedom Fund, United Black Community, representative to the Leadership Council for Pan-African Nationalism, coordinator of manhood training at Ujamaa School, and many, many other things, member of the DC Citywide Kwanzaa Planning Committee, and the executive director of Appeal Incorporated, a Black empowerment organization in this community, the recipient, both of them, of many, many different awards. So, you know, let's just go on and get right down into it. You know, my brothers, Mourn or Scorn, the Black world, but not just the Black world. I'm just curious with you. We haven't talked in advance. I don't know, you might be mourning. You might be scorning. You might be doing both. You might be doing one. Obi, let's start with you. Mourn or Scorn? What's your take with respect to the demise of Queen Elizabeth?
Thank you for the opportunity to be on. I'll start by saying it's always good to be in your presence, always good to be in your company. And best case scenario, I've gotten about 8 phone calls in the last week to discuss this. And for all of the people who reached out, I said to them, best case scenario, and harmony with the African fighting spirit, I'm thinking that they're gonna call me to discuss this being the 50th anniversary of Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, Ghana's first president, the Pan-African giant, passing away April 27, 1972, to be exact. I'm thinking that they would call me with excitement to discuss that this is the 100th birthday of Achmé Sékou Touré, Guinea's first president and the leader of the Guinean Revolution, who was born January 9, 1922. And the Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, on the Day of the African Child, we did a play about him called Ready for the Revolution, about him and the sister who led that liberation struggle, led the women, Mbali Kamara. But we do things come your way in different ways. So I'll just say this much in response to what you're asking, Mourn or Scorn. It depends on where you fall on the spectrum. If you ask Jay-Z and Beyonce, they're probably mourning. If you ask Oprah Winfrey, she's probably mourning. If you ask Barack and Michelle Obama, they're probably mourning. If you ask those who feel historically obligated to fight against colonialism, to fight against imperialism, to fight against every manifestation of oppression and dehumanization that we face, they feel that this is just another opportunity to magnify and intensify our resistance. So it depends who you ask, when where they fall on the spectrum in relationship to this. And the Queen's record is what it is. She visited the African continent 20 times, according to her profile. And one of the things we know that the British monarchy was responsible for was the establishment of the King's African Rifles, which was started in 1902 and ended in the 1960s. And her, based on her makeup and her capacity in relationship to their protocol, she was the colonel in chief of that. The same way every president of the United States is automatically the commander in chief. These were the Africans who were forced to fight on the side of their colonial master against their country's resistance. So while the Mau Mau was going on in Kenya, the Land and Freedom Army, another group of Africans, fought with the British to maintain British colonialism in Kenya. Idi Amin, the former prime minister of Uganda, fought in the King's African Rifles. Many Africans fought in the King's African Rifles. Those who know the struggle in Zimbabwe from the second Chimurenga from 1966 to 1980, know that a group of Zimbabweans did not fight with the Zimbabwe African National Union, did not fight with the Zimbabwe African People's Union, but they fought with the Sellers Scouts, who was named after Frederick Sellers, who was a partner of Cecil Rhodes, during the creation of the British South African Company, and they fought militarily against their own liberation movements. So the monarchy of Britain always aided the mercenaries and the renegades who, based on confusion, based on brainwashing, felt patriotically obligated to fight against their own people's genuine resistance. The Queen's legacy is connected to one Lord Arthur Balfour, who was the one who made the declaration to create Zionist Israel. So anybody who is a strong advocate of Zionist Israel, they may be in mourning. Anybody who knows the career of Harry Belafonte, in the same way that Ray Charles' name is synonymous with singing America the Beautiful, Harry Belafonte popularized a song in this country, which he brags about, called Hava Nagila. And Hava Nagila was a fighting song for the Israeli Defense Forces celebrating the Balfour Declaration, which paved the way for the Truman administration to bring to life officially the Zionist State of Israel. So anybody who feels obligated to stand with the Palestinians, anybody who feels obligated to remind the African continent that right now, 47 of the 55 African nations have Israeli embassies in them, and Zionist Israel has observer status at the African Union. Some of them are probably mourning or pretending to be sad. Now, Madiba Nelson Mandela had a pet name for Queen Elizabeth, Motla Lepu, which stands for which comes to one who comes with rain. And they said that she was one of
one who comes with rain.
Yeah, want to come with rain. That's what it means in Nongsa. And so this is, so depending on where you are, but of course, she was supposed to be the diplomatic face that represented the band-aid of imperialism, the band-aid of colonialism, and the band-aid of all the atrocities that the Labour and Conservative Party, the M16, the intelligence agency of Britain, committed on the African continent, committed in the Caribbean, committed in China, committed in Asia, everywhere they seek to reign, conquer, and dominate people, both the human and material resource. So obviously she represents that for us, but we would warn people at a moment where we are trying, part of the decolonization process is to make a tactical shift from embracing a narrative of victimization to a narrative of resistance. Because she reigned for 70 years, she witnessed many defeats. She witnessed Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah and the Convention People's Party defeat British colonialism with a positive action campaign, what we call nonviolence in this country. And between 1957 and 1960, 35 nations in Africa got their independence.
Yes, indeed.
She got a chance to witness Kenya defeat British colonialism in an armed struggle. She got a chance to witness Zimbabwe defeat the second most powerful colonial army ever assembled on the African continent in modern history. So she got a chance to witness many defeats. She got a chance to see the people of Malay for 12 years take up arms against the British colonial terrorists in their nation. So she got a she witnessed a lot of defeats, and she realized that on a diplomatic front, on a political front, on a military front, an organized people will not be deprived the ultimate victory. She called herself in 1994, knighting President Mugabe, because she knew that the time had come for Zimbabweans to take action, because both the United States and Britain reneged on the Lancaster House negotiations, which were between 1980 and 1990, a transfer of power and a transfer of the resources where the land would come back to us. And because Britain failed to honor that, the United States failed to honor that, she knew that the Zimbabweans were eventually going to claim their land. So 6 years after they knighted President Mugabe, a diplomatic measure, 4,500 white commercial farmers of British Rhodesian colonial ancestry, who dominated 70% of that country's most resourceful land, saw that land reclaimed by the masses of the people. And the land went back to 350,000 families in a nation where the land comprises of six people, reaffirming Brother Malcolm's affirmation that land is the basis of all independence. So she witnessed a lot.
So go ahead. I want to bring Kelechi into this because I know, first of all, thank you for this history lesson. That's why we know you're a Pan-Africanist history, a teacher and a famed playwright and all of that. But I want to bring Dr. Kelechi Egwim into this discussion right now as well in terms of Mourn or Scorn, the Black World and Queen Elizabeth's death. So what are some of your reflections or reaction that you have seen from the Black world, Dr. Egwim?
Yeah, well, and thank you, Nkechi, for inviting me. And it's always good to be in the good company of my brother, Obi. We've done some good things together. I appreciate the work that he does and continues to do in the community, especially with the children, because he is a fountain of information, especially history, especially African history. He said a lot. What I would have definitely agreed with. I'm really only concerned about how we feel about it or how we respond to it. And the death of the Queen of England, it reminds me of the schizophrenic reality we live in as African people. Because even as African people, even as people who, based on your positioning in the effect of the Queen since her rise to position in 1952 and beyond, people still have who should be mourning based on the history, who should be celebrating, I should say, based on the history. Are mourning, and I don't really think that we should be celebrating either, because when your enemy dies a natural death, I don't think that you have anything to celebrate. You have nothing to do with it. So that's not even a celebration in and of itself. But you have Africans who are who have their flags that have staff. Kenya, Nigeria, the list goes on and on. And these are countries that, England is one of those interesting countries that impacted Africa, from east to west to south. It wasn't as segregated as some other European nations. I'll give one particular example. Of course, I'm Nigerian, and one thing that impacted us the most is, and I'm Igbo in particular, was the Biafra War, which of course, happened, very much, under her reign, and was, and some may not know the history of Biafra. I won't give too long a history of it, but basically Nigeria was created in the early 1900s in order to, it's part of the, Belgium Conference, the carving of Africa, but Nigeria particularly was created as a nation that could never rule itself. And that was done by essentially cobbling together multiple nations, especially three in particular, the Hausas, which also combined with the Fulanis in the north, the southwest you have the Yorubas, in the southeast you had Igbos and Bibos and similarly cultured entities. Those weren't a nation per se, but they were a cultural group. The Igbos were never a nation, but we were a federation of nations. But by cobbling these groups together, and these groups were adversarial towards each other, they had communication, but there were no diplomatic ties per se. They knew that by forcing these nations to come together, they could never self-govern successfully. And that was by design. That was something that that was put together under her reign. And then under her reign, when Nigeria declared independence in 1960, the Biafrans, the Southeasterners were like, we out. We weren't trying to be part of this Nigerian thing anyway. We trying to go back and become an independent state, because England, like all these European countries, they when they are forced to allow independence because they've seen that it's simply not tenable for them to maintain forced colonialism, they create these deals with the countries that remain, same with Ghana, same with, you know, Nigeria, so forth, that give them perpetual access to the natural resources. They did that with Nigeria. They had no contract with Biafra. So when Biafra declared independence and said, we out, England was basically, they were cut off from all those deals they made when they were leaving. So England funded the Nigerian government to attack and essentially try to commit genocide on the Biafran people. This was under her watch. And you have people today who are so-called champions of Biafra, and they're proudly mourning the queen. You know, the leader of I'll put that in quotes, the self-proclaimed leader. Many certainly would call him the leader because, you know, there's nobody else, Nnamdi Kanu, who is currently being imprisoned by the Nigerian government, but that's a whole other thing. Him and his IPOB, his group are in mourning for the queen. And it's crazy because you're Biafran. This is a woman who literally tried to exterminate your people with bombs. You know, my family personally, you know, we were forced to hide in the bushes in the middle of the night every night because they would drop bombs on farms and villages and anything they could you know get their hands on. So this is a legacy of the queen. You know, same with the Mau Mau, but the Obi already talked about Kenya and it, of course, you know, we know about South Africa, which was a British colony, but still had a lot of influence there and supported the maintaining of apartheid. So I think if you are a conscious African person, you certainly shouldn't be mourning. I wouldn't say you should be celebrating. Like I said, she died a natural death. I mean, I think if it had gone differently, then we can talk about whether we should celebrate or not. But it's definitely, there's a lot of confusion in the African world right now, especially on the continent, because, you know, we're so well educated in the colonial system. Most of these countries are still using the same exact literal educational system that was left for them by the British. So their citizens are, you know, they are torn. You know, they know the history to some degree, enough to know that this is not a friend of yours that passed away. This is not some innocent grandmother, you know, that has, you know, beautiful children, that has, you know, this is somebody who literally has your, I've had the opportunity as it is, it were, to tour of Buckingham Palace. And, you know, there's some parts of the palace where you're not allowed to take pictures or video. They're trying to take your camera away, what have you. And these are the areas where they essentially have, you know, you've seen the you know, the Benin bronzes. They've got gold. They've got precious jewels.
They got all that stuff, huh?
Right. And that area, they take away your photographic equipment because they don't want you to capture that. This is in her house. I'm not talking about in the museum. This is Buckingham Palace. This is all those structures they have our stolen goods in them right now.
So let me just throw out a couple of things before we go on. Something I did not know, and I know Brother Obi, you were close to Kwame Ture, also known as Stokely Carmichael, that the UK targeted Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture, in a secret campaign distributing literature from fake sources to demean and to discredit him. Just stuff that I didn't even know. Stuff that's happening right now, I mean, across the world, in the islands, Jamaica and Antigua and Barbuda may cut ties to the British monarch. People are calling for reparations. You know, there's just a lot. Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon, has come out, you know, against a Carnegie Mellon professor who, now, I might not have said what she said. I will say that. I mean, I might have failed her, but I might not have said it. But I don't know. What do you think about this type of backlash and the things that's coming out from the Black world now in the wake of the death? I'm going to turn back to you, Baba Obi.
Well, what you asked about in relationship to Kwame Ture, in 1967, My father helped organize Brother Kwame's first visit to London in 1967 for the Dialectics of Liberation Conference. And they did a comparison of Black power in London to Black power in the United States. But Brother Kwame was ultimately banned from London by the Labor Secretary, Roy Jenkins, which led to also his banning from Trinidad, his place of birth. And because they looked very closely, the Black Power movement, it was on the heels of the Fifth Pan-African Congress in 1945 in Manchester, England. So the children of Nkrumah, the children of Kenyatta, the children of C.L.R. James, the children of Paul Robeson, who in terms of genealogy, my father and Brother Kwame would represent, here they are gravitating to Black Power. And at that exact moment in history, Maurice Bishop was studying law at Gray's Inn, who became the Prime Minister of Grenada, organizing the most significant revolution in the Caribbean since the Cuban Revolution in 1959 and the Haitian Revolution in 1804. Fela Kuti was studying music in London at the time. Tony Martin, the Garveyite, was organizing with Caribbean-born African students there. Many of the students who went on to join liberation movements in Zimbabwe and Zambia, members of the Pan-Africanist Congress of Azania, all of them were there in school at the time. Walter Rodney was studying. In relationship to the issue of the Commonwealth, Zimbabwe was suspended for reclaiming their land from the Commonwealth in 2003, but ultimately withdrew. And one of the things about the trade unions in the Caribbean, they still had ties to the Labor Solidarity Center in the United States and the AFL-CIO, which is nothing but a front for the CIA, but they also had ties to M16, the British intelligence, and the two political parties in Britain. So in the last 50, 60 years, we saw this happen. So it caused them to have to reevaluate their Africa policy. Even though when people think about Ethiopia and Eritrea, you automatically think of Italy, the British government was responsible for United Nations Security Council sanctions on Eritrea that lasted for nearly 10 years under a false claim that Eritrea was harboring al-Shabaab terrorists. And the Security Council sent an inspection team there, saw that it was false, and it still took them nearly 6 years to lift those sanctions. And it is because of the resolve of the Eritrean people, Eritrea being the only nation in Africa at the present moment to have free education and free healthcare for its people. The role of the monarchy in the bombing of Libya in conjunction with the NATO alliance spearheaded by the Obama administration, all of this is chronicled. The positive thing about all of this is for many of our people who accept an amputated narrative of the African experience, where they look at our experience in North America in isolation from our experience throughout the Americas and Europe and Africa, of course, this gives us a chance to show them the how widespread the Queen's impact was at the moment, but it is diverting attention away from things that we cannot allow it to. Ghana was once in their clutches when it was the Gold Coast. The current president of Ghana just assaulted the culture of his own nation. He changed Founders Day, which is Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's birthday. Some say it's the 18th of September, some say it's September 21st. He changed it back to when the United Gold Coast Convention was created, which was a liberal outlet that only wanted to reduce colonial oppression. They did not want to liberate Ghana from colonialism, but the Convention People's Party did that. And his two uncles started the first opposition party financed and supported by the British. The Movement for Democratic Change, which is used to create regime change in Zimbabwe, was created by the Westminster Foundation for Democracy, supported by the Queen, supported by the British government, and supported by the US government. Sir Richard Branson's plan to take over tourism in Zimbabwe had the blessing of the Queen. So all of this goes into play. The fact that George Soros and the Open Society Initiative are financing 350 civil society groups in Zimbabwe, the other 50 financed by the National Democratic Institute, Madeleine Albright's pet project, and 14 by the National Endowment for Democracy. But I wanted to go back to Eritrea real quickly.
But this is Human Rights and Justice, WPFW 89.3 FM. We're talking about Mourn or Scorn, the Black World and Queen Elizabeth's Death. And our two guests are Obi Egbuna Jr., London-born, Washington, D.C. raised, Pan-African educator, organizer, and playwright, and Dr. Kelechi Egwim, native Nigerian and longtime D.C. community activist, organizer, and commentator. If you want to call in, if you have a question for our guests, you dial 202-588-0893. Okay, go on and continue.
Okay, I wanted to say, people might not be mourning for the queen. They may have never got on their knees, because my formal education started in Nigeria. I went to a primary school in a place called Enugu. And you had to pray to the queen in the morning. Mm-hmm. My parents wouldn't let me do it, but this was something that we were subjected to. You may have people who have never said all hail the queen, mm-hmm. but they carry out the agenda of Britain. You have organizations in this country who are spreading falsehoods about Zimbabwe and Eritrea right now, saying that they were buying weapons from the U.S. Africa Military Command and never gave Zimbabwe or Eritrea diplomats in Washington the courtesy of going to sit with them to confirm whether it was true.
Obi, we got a caller. Let's see what caller has to say. Sure. Question and comment. Let us know who you are, where you're calling from, and what your question or comment is. Greetings. How are you? Who is this?
Yes, Sister Milagros.
Hello, Milagros. How are you?
How are you? I want to shout out to the brother Obi, because he and I know one another.
What's up?
Hi, brother Obi. You're not going to remember me. I'm part of your Panther Party back in London, back in 1960s.
No, that's my dad. It ain't me.
Yeah.
I don't know if Obi was born in 1960. We can't talk about his daddy, the great Pan-African.
Well, you know what I'm thinking? He's still alive. What can I say? You know, I remember nothing but the power that the people had back in those years. I was young. I had just come out of Cuba. I'm Cuban. And my mom had sent me to London with my aunt.
Okay.
When I found you guys doing what you did, I was so doggone impressed. So I wanted to become a member, because I'm a talker. I can convince anybody to do anything, I think.
Okay.
I'm also an attorney. I just want to shout out to you, my brother. Now, you are the junior, am I right?
That's correct.
Okay. You remember Brother Howe? Darkest Howe?
I'm familiar with him, but I never had the opportunity to meet him. I lived there till I was 3 years old, sister, and I wasn't born till 1969.
Uh-oh, yeah, I'll be your mother. Right. At any rate, I want to thank you and my sister, who's doing a great job, for letting me call in. When I heard you, I said, no, he's not still living, because he got to be as old as I am.
Thank you.
Milagros, we're going to have you on one day.
You're very welcome.
I appreciate it. She said she had lived in London. I just want to mention something real quick. The Julia Wright, who's in Paris, the daughter of Richard Wright, wrote something about mourning our own queens, okay? And she wrote this wonderful thing dealing with our own queens. You know, Mamie Till Mobley, the queen, the mother of Emmett Till Mobley. She wrote this whole thing dealing with the queen, Martin Luther King's wife. She talked about our ancestral queens, Harriet Tubman, Ida B. Wells, Bell Hooks. She talked about the queen, the mother of George and Jonathan Jackson, Georgia Jackson. She talked about the living who are not yet, she said not yet even elders. I mean, some of them are elders. Asada Shakur, Pam Africa, Joanna Fernandez. Mm. She said, Julia Wright said, we are blessed with so many Black queens alive and dead. We are so rich. So we need to be mourning our queens. And everybody said, when you say the queen, you know, I think of Queen Mother Moore. That's the first thing that came to my mind.
Happy 75th birthday to Asada Shakur.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Is today?
No, not today. We're celebrating her the whole year.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
Let me bring
Kelechi in real quick. Go on, Dr.
Right. I was going to say, you know, I think this is an opportunity, and I think this looking situations that come up like this is an opportunity. This is an opportunity for us to do some very tangible things, because even as we speak, there are still several African nations or nations that are predominantly populated by African people that are still part of the monarchy. They are still ruled by the king of England. And they have not, just last year, Barbados became a republic and replaced the queen as their head of state. There are still countries that folks would be surprised to find that Jamaica is still, part of the monarchy. The king of England.
But they're talking about referendums and all like that. The casket's been thrust wide open. Go on, Baba.
And that's why this is an opportunity. The death of the queen is an opportunity to actually make strides in Jamaica, in Grenada, in Belize, in Bahamas, in Antigua, in Papua New Guinea, in St. Kitts, in St. Lucia. This is an opportunity. If we just focus on, some of this distraction of the pomp and circumstance and don't realize the opportunity to actually bring about change, because right now, the amount of force, the effect of the force, the people on the ground on what happens is greater than it will be after things sort of die down. I mean, there's a reason why, revolts of enslaved African people happened while, the white folk were celebrating or distracted otherwise. Usually Christmas Day was the best day for a revolt. There's a reason for that. In other words, we need to be supporting African people on the ground in these locations, to encourage them and to support them in finally coming under the reign of the monarchy. We know that it's just a step, but it's an important step. I mean, Barbados is still part of the.
We have another caller coming in. I want to make sure we get our community participation in. Caller, who are you and where are you calling from? What's your comment?
Mr. Brown, I'm calling from Maryland.
Mr. Brown from Maryland, greetings. What's your question?
I listen to the show a lot of times, you and Roach on the air, but let me say this, Miss. The history is fine, but the history doesn't mean nothing to our people until we get institutions that can give this information to our younger people, because otherwise we're going to raise up young people going to be enemy to themselves and their own people. That's why we have a killing problem, murdering problem in the Black community. And the police supposed to be fixing this stuff, and nobody does anything about it. I was a wise guy when I was 15, 16. I heard Stoker Carmichael, I read Malcolm material. But until we get some institutions to teach this information to our young people, I don't care. You don't have to change the school system, but you have to have independent schools. We have a lot of churches that sit there empty, nothing in there, nothing going on. We need to go back there and teach our younger people the history that's split it all every day. There were people, good people there, good information, but it's not going to do any good teaching to the people that already know this information. We need to get children. I was listening to children, little kids the other day. I just moved my area where I'm at. And they was talking to another little fella. They had about three or four of them. They was calling the other little fella a B. And I said, That's what this problem comes from, that we have killing in our community. Just pull a trigger on each other. Don't give a daggone about it. Until we get institutions, like I say, to teach our young people the information we need to teach them, we're going to have a bigger problem, Miss. We're going to be enemies to ourselves. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. I really appreciate your comment. You got the perfect people on the line right now, because Obi Egbuna is chomping at the bit right now, because you're talking about someone who's talking about teaching children and doing it in a creative fashion. Obi, let me let you go on and respond to that.
I appreciate the brother's heartfelt sentiments, but I don't think he heard the beginning. We have the Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, brother. And in July of this year, the beginning of July, as a post Day of the African Child celebration, as this was the 30th anniversary of that, we did a play called Ready for the Revolution about Sekou Touré and Mbale Kamara. We performed with children out of Cuba. We performed with children out of Eritrea. We performed with children out of Haiti. And we performed with some children out of DC that have a steel pan group. You can get in contact with me at the Twitter is at JREGBUNA. The Instagram is at OBIEGBUNA15. My email address is OBIEGBUNA15@gmail.com. And for all of you who have children out there from 5 years old to 18 that you feel would benefit from being part of the Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, the Mass Emphasis Children's History, Education, and Navigational Institute, the
Excuse me for 1 minute, brother. Let me say this like I'm going for real. Let me say this. Until we do this thing on a large scale and you have people go to these churches every Sunday, they flock in there to give the preachers their money. And to me, you're not going to make a big difference if you got a small handful of people.
You know, but my point is coming. Just come and see. Come and see our work.
Caller, we hear you. We hear you loud and clear.
Come and see our work, man.
Yeah.
Come and see our work.
We have institution builders on this line.
Come and see our work, man. In addition to the work that Mass Emphasis does, you know, with children.
You listen, come and see it. Don't come and see it for yourself. And bring some children with you when you come, too. That's how we get more children involved.
So I don't want to argue back and forth, but I will say also, Kelechi also is involved with the citywide Kwanzaa programs where their activities all throughout that Kwanzaa week focused on young people and children and creating history, institution building, the creation of a credit union through appeal, through the various projects and study classes. So, I mean, I'm just saying, I see it happening before my very eyes. I hear you. I hear you call it. But I feel the solution within, that's right here on this call.
And not just during Kwanzaa, because throughout the year, appeal has a Saturday school in the morning, regardless of where you are. Anywhere in the country, anywhere in the world. This week, this Saturday, we have Sister Nubia Kai talking about the Maroons. Last Saturday, we have Brother Tony Browder talking about, you know, the 25th Dynasty and Asa Hilliard Project and John Henry Clark. So the education is happening. The information is being put out there. If you may not be in the environment where you're connected to it, you know, but it is available. And there are brothers and sisters doing this education work. It is critical to our liberation.
Absolutely. And I will say this, I do know we can always do more. And what Brother Obi said when he first started, when he said got all these phone calls over the past week or so since the death of the Queen, and he was thinking people were gonna be talking about this or that or the other. But what are we talking about? We're talking about the Queen. We should be talking 365 days a year about the things Brother Obi was saying so that we don't just hear about it on a knee-jerk response when the media has deemed something important and something relevant. So I definitely believe in 365 days of history, Black history, and African history, and the like. Yeah.
And what people confuse is impact and visibility. Some people want to see things that more visible, but what is visible doesn't necessarily make impact. That's something very important, because I specifically said we organize an activity that involved children in DC, Canada, Trinidad, Jamaica, Liberia, Sierra Leone, one activity. And we were able to bring African children together from all these places. If people don't consider that impactful, I don't know what to say. So, I mean, you know, so people have to listen very carefully when they hear us, but I'm one who believes, matter of fact, that's why I don't even like taking interviews unless it's in the capacity of us promoting our work. And at the local level, someone who I'm gonna bring back on your show, Mama Nkechi, who made history, a brother named Anton White, who I consider the incarnation of George Jackson, who did 31 years in the federal system, him and his co-defendant pushed all the way to the Supreme Court and had the Supreme Court overturn all these cases of nonviolent offenders who've been in prison since for the last 20 plus years. And he just finished doing 31 years, and he's ready to start a program right on the ground in Washington, D.C. And I want to bring him on and his co-defendant to talk about that experience.
We're on crossroads with Roach Brown and our co-host.
Exactly. And one of the other things his co-defendant and I talked about yesterday was him joining the National Conference of Black Lawyers, yes, so he can handle incarcerated affairs, because he already has a bunch of cases lined up of people who he feel he can get released based on his expertise with the law. So we just want people to know what we do at the local level, what we do at the national level, and what we do at the global level.
So let me just get back to the Black world and the Queen, because there are renewed cries. I mean, I have not heard more talking about reparations across the globe, you know, just in the past couple of years. And I've heard in the whole 50 years that I've been working on the issue of reparations. I mean, I don't know what you all, what does that mean to you in terms of people being very vocal, countries, islands, you know, talking about breaking off from the crown and holding referendums to establish their own, you know, republic. I remember my own grounding in the New African Independence Movement when we were talking about a plebiscite to determine what our self-determination, what our political destiny would be for Black people here in this country. Well, I mean, I'm seeing this blossoming across the world, and I just seen an uptick in that just in the past week, as a result of new possibilities, new opportunities, I think, as you all said, that people are seeing in light of the possibility of a new world order. What do y'all think?
I mean, absolutely, and that's what I say. I always see these world events as an opportunity, not focus on what the distraction is, but what's the opportunity for African people? How can we take this time and elevate ourselves in some form or fashion? Let's not worry about, this is only going to be so much change. Change is change. Progress is progress. We still have way too many countries part of the so-called Commonwealth of Nations in 2022. African nations should not be engaged in those type of treaties that are headed by their former colonial masters. This is an opportunity for countries to begin to make a change that has been talked about on the ground level, but this event has brought up a groundswell of emotion and interest, you know, not just in reparations, but in actual divestments and other things that should have been done a long time ago. So whether we do it or not is one thing, but that's where our discussion should be. How can we take this opportunity, that's what it is, to elevate African people globally?
So let me give you each 1 minute as we're closing to answer that question that Kelechi said, or however you want to close. How do we use this moment that we find ourselves in to advance our struggle around the world, or however you want to use as your closing, like 1 minute remark to each of you? Who wants to start?
I'll let Brother Obi go.
Okay.
Bob. Okay. Breaking ties with the United States Agency for International Development. That's one way, because at a moment where you have 409 million Africans on the African continent living on $1.90 a day or less, at a moment where, according to Forbes magazine, there are 2,775 billionaires, but they are nearly 700 million people that live on $1.90, and 409 million of them are in Africa, which means we represent 70% of the world's extreme poor. Of the 25 extreme poor nations on the planet, only three are not in Africa: Haiti, the Solomon Islands, and Afghanistan. And of the 60 countries that receive least developed country status, when you surrender your economy to the United Nations, nearly 47 of them are African nations. So anything that we can do politically to be self-determining, we have to do. Organizing from the ground up.
Got to do. All right, yeah. Kelechi, half a minute.
We need to seek out grassroots efforts there are 14 primarily African nations right now that are still under the monarchy. And of course, I think it's an opportunity, and this is what we should be pushing if we're part of nations like Nigeria, like Ghana, if we're involved in having any reach in governments of Uganda to come together and come out of this Commonwealth of Nations.
Okay, thank you so very much. This is Nkechi Taifa with Human Rights and Justice. I want to thank you for listening to our second episode. And you can catch us on YouTube, the Nkechi Taifa channel. You can hear us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, and the like. Thank you to our podcast partners, Canopy Collective. And get up, stand up for your rights.